Professor Dave again, let's revisit the senses.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We just went through an overview of how visual information makes it to the brain. So what about the other senses? Once again, we looked at the ears and nose and tongue from an anatomical standpoint in the Anatomy and Physiology playlist. So make sure to view this tutorial if you're rusty on some of the terminology. Otherwise, let's go ahead and take a look at the mechanisms by which the brain receives information from these sensory organs, just like we did for the eyes. When we looked at visual processing, we learned about hierarchical organization. We saw how light is received by photoreceptors and transduction occurs. This results in neural signals which travel to the lateral geniculate nuclei, then to the primary visual cortex, then the secondary visual cortex, and then the visual association cortex. A similar kind of hierarchy applies to all the senses. We can show this in a more general way, going from receptors to some thalamic relay nuclei, to a primary sensory cortex, then secondary, finishing up at an association cortex. As information travels through this pathway, the neurons exhibit greater specificity and complexity in their response to stimuli, demonstrating functional segregation, where each tier performs different kinds of analysis. We can also make the distinction between sensation and perception. Sensation involves the detection of a stimulus, which occurs at the sensory organs, while perception involves the integration of information and its interpretation, which happens exclusively in the brain. Sensory systems heavily feature parallel processing, such that a signal can be split up into parallel pathways, and thus produce multiple effects. Putting this together, we can say that any sensory system is hierarchical, functionally segregated, and parallel. The combined activity in all of these regions is what generates perception, and therefore our subjective experience of reality. Let's apply this understanding to each sensory system, starting with the auditory system. As we know, sound involves the vibrations of molecules, typically the molecules in the air, and these vibrations produce longitudinal waves that interact with the ears in such a way so as to produce perception that we call hearing. Just the way that vision is limited to a specific region of the electromagnetic spectrum, hearing is also limited to certain frequencies, and for most people, that would be from around 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz, where Hz are inverse seconds, meaning a particular number of cycles or wavelengths per second. Most of the sounds we hear around us produce very complex waveforms, as they are combinations of a number of different sine waves. We've already learned about the tympanic membrane, or eardrum, found in the inner ear, and we know that this is the structure that sound waves stimulate to allow for hearing. The vibrations travel through these three small bones, into the oval window, and then to the cochlea. The internal membrane of the cochlea is the organ of Corti, which is the auditory receptor organ. Vibrations cause hair cells in this region to stimulate firing in the axons of the auditory nerve. Different frequencies of sound stimulate hair cells at different points along the basilar membrane, and this information is encoded in the resulting signal. This signal travels to the cochlear nuclei, then to the superior olives, then the inferior colliculi, and then the medial geniculate nuclei of the thalamus. From here, as expected, information heads to the primary auditory cortex, secondary auditory cortex, and auditory association cortex. Just like the dorsal and ventral streams for visual processing, there seems to be an anterior auditory pathway leading to the prefrontal cortex and a posterior auditory pathway leading to the posterior parietal cortex. much about the auditory system is still being actively researched. So let's move on to the somatosensory system. The sense of touch is not as simple to define as the others, which each have a distinct organ responsible for producing sensation. Somatosensations actually originate in three different ways. The exteroceptive system senses things that touch your skin. The proprioceptive system monitors the position and balance of your body. And the interoceptive system provides general information about things inside the body. Because we typically associate the sense of touch as things that we touch with our hands or that brush up against our bodies, let's focus on the exteroceptive system. This has three divisions. One perceives mechanical stimuli, which is the more rigidly tactile division. One perceives thermal stimuli, or changes in temperature. And one perceives nociceptive stimuli, which means pain. All of this is due to cutaneous receptors that sit in the skin all over the body. These can be of a few different varieties. The simplest are just free nerve endings that detect temperature changes and pain. From there, we can see Merkel's discs, which respond to skin indentation, and slightly larger Ruffini endings, which respond to gradual skin stretching. Finally, the largest are the Pacinian corpuscles. These respond to sudden displacements of the skin rather than constant pressure. The difference between these functionalities helps distinguish the difference in sensation between being tapped on the shoulder versus faintly feeling your clothes on your body throughout the day. So how does information get from these receptors to the brain? Nerves relay this information to the spinal cord via dorsal roots, and each section of the body that is innervated by the dorsal roots of a particular segment of the spinal cord is called a dermatome. We can see all the dermatomes of the human body here, and the specific vertebrae they correspond to, although there is considerable overlap. From here, information will head up one of several pathways to the brain, and the two major ones are the dorsal column medial lemniscus system, which typically carries information about touch and proprioception, and the anterolateral system, which typically deals with pain and temperature. For the first of these, neurons ascend in dorsal columns and enter the brain at the dorsal column nuclei. They then cross over to the other side of the brain, ascend in the medial lemniscus towards the ventral posterior nucleus of the thalamus, and then typically project to the primary somatosensory cortex. The anterolateral system is comprised of the spinothalamic tract, the spinoreticular tract, and the spinotectal tract, which go up the spinal cord all the way to the thalamus, where information is then distributed to the somatosensory cortex. The primary somatosensory cortex is organized according to a map of the surface of the body, so specific regions correspond to specific body parts. This is illustrated on the somatosensory homunculus, which designates the corresponding regions with body parts shown in sizes that are proportional to the amount of the cortex that is dedicated to them. It is clear that certain areas get the bulk of the focus, like the hands, as well as the lips and tongue, for obvious reasons. Signals that travel from these body parts to the somatosensory cortex are then shuttled to areas of the association cortex in the prefrontal and posterior parietal cortex. Finally, let's take a look at smell and taste, also referred to as olfaction and gustation. These are similar senses in that they monitor the chemical environment. Whereas vision utilizes light as stimulus, these senses use molecules. When we inhale through the nose, molecules in the air interact with receptors in the nose. Any substance that is volatile, meaning it will readily enter the gas phase, can potentially interact with these receptors and send a signal to the brain such that it can be perceived. Likewise, when food is placed on the tongue, different types of molecules can interact with receptors called taste buds and send signals to the brain such that we can perceive a particular flavor. We introduced these structures in the anatomy and physiology course, so check back there for the basics. To connect things to the brain, for olfaction, we will notice the olfactory receptor cells sitting in the olfactory mucosa, with axons that lead to olfactory bulb. The clusters of neurons near the surface are called olfactory glomeruli. Each of these receives input from a few thousand receptor cells containing the same type of receptor protein, of which there are about 350. From here, neurons project to the brain via olfactory tracts, without any thalamic relay cells in between. They land in regions of the medial temporal lobes, like the amygdala and the piriform cortex. From there, some signals spread around the limbic system, and some go through the thalamus to the orbitofrontal cortex, right behind the eyes. We believe the first of these pathways regulates emotional response to odors, whereas the latter is associated with general odor perception. With the tongue, we are probably familiar with taste buds, which are receptors found in clusters of 50 to 100. There are only a few different taste receptors which correspond to salty, sweet, bitter, sour, and savory flavors. This is in contrast with odor receptors, which can be involved in combinations that yield 1 trillion unique odors. Signals originating here in the tongue will leave the mouth along several cranial nerves and head to the solitary nucleus of the medulla, then on to the ventral posterior nucleus of the thalamus, and then to the primary gustatory cortex and the nearby secondary gustatory cortex. We will expand on all of these pathways in the future. For now, let's move on to some other topics. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.